Friends, welcome to Ulcer Stories. I am starting this series because in my ulcer practice, I come across this prescription for most of the ulcers. But are all ulcers same? As all flowers are just colored petals, still we make an effort to identify if we can. The same approach is needed for ulcers too. All ulcers are an infiltration in cornea, but we can classify the majority. For this, we need to listen to patient's history, pay attention to clinical features, and do a basic microbiological workup of QH to rule out fungal etiology, because it's very common cause of ulcer. How to do QH has already been shared in our previous video. This approach helps in customizing our treatment and moving beyond the routine of treating every ulcer with the same protocol. We are starting with an entity which is not very common, that is rosacea keratitis. As we know, rosacea is a skin disease which affects facial convexities, so cheek, nose, forehead are usually affected. Flushing, a transient hyperemia, is usually considered a first and characteristic feature. Its etiology is primarily inflammatory with vascular component. It is broadly classified in four groups, depending upon the primary manifestation, though these subgroups can overlap. Erythrotelangiectatic group has only redness. Second group has papules and pustules. Third is the phymatous variety, in which there is skin hypertrophy. It is usually seen in elderly males. And fourth group is ocular rosacea, in which eye is also involved. Ocular changes are seen in many patients of rosacea. It primarily affects lid margin, which further leads to conjunctivitis and keratitis. Rarely episcleritis is also observed. Ocular disease severity is not dependent upon skin disease. In fact, in some cases, it may be limited to eye only. Starting with the lids first, telangiectasia, a lacy pattern of blood vessels around meibomian gland orifices, is very characteristic. No doubt, it is easily picked up in Caucasians compared to our darker races. Meibomian glands are inspissated, leading to recurrent calosium. Many patients have blepharitis too. Cultures of lid margins show that prevalence of Staph aureus is higher in rosacea patients. Conjunctival pathology is secondary to MGD. Congestion may be limited to lower bulbar part or it may be diffuse. Conjunctival factors, though not very common, can be seen. In cornea, superficial punctate erosions of the lower part is the most common finding. Superficial vessels may form a penis. In some cases, small pinhead size, very limbal infiltrates develop, which may not take stain in the early stage. But if inflammation is intense, then overlying epithelium gives way and then these lesions take up stain. As the disease progresses, infiltrates develop in the center too. Triangular infiltrates with base towards limbus are very characteristic, though not specific of rosacea. These are called spade infiltrates. Corneal involvement in rosacea may be unilateral or bilateral. Even when bilateral, it will be asymmetrical. Very rarely, repeated episodes at one spot may lead to extreme thinning and even perforation. This middle-aged male patient had asymmetrical disease. Left eye perforated despite being on rosacea treatment for many years. Relapses despite treatment are very common and it's very frustrating for patient and physician both. Regarding management, we cannot change the body's tendency for inflammation and vascular changes. Our efforts are directed towards managing MGD and the bacterial overgrowth. So this involves warm compresses, lid massage and lid hygiene. Local bacteriostatic antibiotic ointments are given. In severe cases, oral doxy for 6 to 12 weeks is usually prescribed. For corneal pathology, lubricants are added in addition to meibomitis treatment. Short course of mild steroids is required for microinfiltrates. For large ulcers, if they look sterile, we can go ahead with the steroid antibiotic combination. But if we are not sure, it's always better to rule out secondary infection by taking scrapings first. Now let's go through two cases. Before we start, I would like to mention that majority of ocular rosacea cases are mild with only meibomitis and occasional conjunctivitis. Corneal involvement is less common and severe keratitis is still rarer. But in this talk, I will discuss those cases in which there was corneal involvement. So a young girl of 14 years came with a history of recurrent redness and chalazion for last 1 year. She was being treated as allergic conjunctivitis. On examination, in addition to meibomitis, she had moderate conjunctival congestion. Corneal findings were typical with inferior corneal haze, superficial vascularization, and few pinhead size infiltrates. All these features suggested ocular rosacea, and she had facial features too. These kind of cases usually respond to routine MGD treatment, in which moist heat at around 45 degree temperature and a forceful lid massage is advised. I usually give erythromycin ointment once a day for at least a month. After that, patient is advised to continue with massage only. These microinfiltrates resolved with 3 to 4 weeks of mild steroid course. However, in some cases, it's much more fulminant. Like in this young 25-year male who presented with the complaint of right eye watering for last 6 months. His ophthalmic consultation 5 months ago mentioned superficial vascular stromal keratitis without any overlying defect, for which he received antibiotic steroid course. After 2 months, he had a relapse of symptoms, but he consulted another place. This time he had multiple infiltrates which were considered as viral, and ACV ointment was started. On examination, he had severe meibomitis, moderate conjunctival congestion, and a central sterile looking infiltrate with overlying epithelial defect and intense leash of vessels, indicating a long standing pathology. On asking, he revealed that he had redness since childhood with cheek erythema in bright light. These features helped in reaching the diagnosis of rosacea keratitis, and we put him on antibiotic steroids and doxycycline. Warm compresses and lid massage was started after acute episode was over, because when the eye is inflamed with the infiltrate, usually at that time doing lid massage is not possible. This is the picture after 6 weeks of treatment. Meibomitis treatment was continued, and this patient needed a lot of counseling because relapses can happen in these cases. Due to rarity of the disease, we are likely to misdiagnose ocular rosacea. Our first patient was diagnosed as allergic. Certain clues can be helpful. In allergy, upper tarsal is affected, whereas rosacea conjunctivitis is usually inferior bulbar. Secondly, in allergy, diffuse congestion can happen, but then it is usually associated with limbal hypertrophy. Seasonal association is another differentiating feature. Presence of lid margin telangiectasia and facial features is another helpful clue. But many times there is no papule pustule, and patient may be having just flushing on exposure to heat and hot beverages. So it's only on asking that patient reveal this. Second patient was diagnosed as HSK. Rosacea infiltrates are mostly very small microinfiltrates associated with superficial vessels, whereas immune infiltrates of HSK are usually larger, central. Sometimes herpetic lesions are peripheral, as we have shown in this example, but then associated immune ring gives a hint towards HSK. Maximum confusion happens in those cases where rosacea ulcers are few, central and large. But in these cases, lid margin and skin features can help us in accurate diagnosis. I hope this small video is of help to my colleagues. Thanks for watching.